Hello friends, welcome to the last part of the video series of module 2 from network and cyber security. From module 2 we'll be considering email security. We'll be considering secure MIME certificate processing and domain key identified mail concept in this particular video. Abhilash KJ, Assistant Professor, Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, Bahubali College of Engineering, will host this session. So we have considered in the previous section, so it is required for the certificate processing at the sender as well as the receiver part in order to complete the SMIME conversation or SMIME information exchange. So SMIME makes use of public key certificates that will conform to the version 3 of X509. Here, SMIME managers may use the configuration for each client with a list of the trusted keys and with a certificate revocation list. Here, the responsibility of the local or the maintaining certificates need to be verified by incoming signature as well as to encrypt the outgoing messages. Here, the certificates are signed by the certificate authorities, in other terms called as CAs. So here, so this entire operation could be handled by an entity which is referred as a user agent. So the SMIME user has several key management functions which user agent. So the first function is the key generation. Under key generation, the user of some relative administrative utility such as having a LAN or management or one associated with the entire network management or one particular set of an institutional institution comprises of multiple segments of LAN that are connected together, and one who is responsible for handling one set of LAN management is considered as an administrative utility. In this case, he must be capable of generating a separate Diffie-Hellman or the DSS key pairs, and he should be capable of generating the RSA key pairs. And at the same time, the user agent should be generating RSA key pairs with a length in the range of 768 to 1024 bits, must not generate a length less than that of 512 bits. So this is a requirement that is posed by the user agent under key generation function. The second function is in terms of registration. Here, the user's public key must be registered with the certification authority in order to receive an X509 public key certificate. And the last function of user agent or the role of user agent is to certificate storage and retrieval. And user may require an access to local list of the certificates in order to verify the incoming mails or incoming signature or to encrypt the outgoing messages. So thus, this has to be maintained at one particular part. Those user agent is responsible for doing it. Such list is maintained by the user or from the local administrative entity on behalf of the number of users. So next we will consider the next function, which is nothing but verisign certificates. So there are multiple companies which are providing the certificate authority services. For example, Nortel has designed an enterprise CA solution and can provide SMIME support within an organization. There are some internet based CAs such as VeriSign, GTE and the US Postal Service. Of this, most widely used is a VeriSign certificate authority service. So we'll consider the brief set of VeriSign certificates in this session. So VeriSign provides the CA service that is intended to be compatible with SMIME and a variety of other application. It issues an X509 certificates with the product name of VeriSign Digital IDs. So as of early 1998, over 35 commercial websites were using VeriSign server digital IDs, and over 1 million consumers of digital IDs has been issued to users of Netscape as well as the Microsoft browsers. So the contained in a digital ID comprises of owner's public key. At minimum, each digital ID comprises of owner's public key, owner's name or the alias. It will be having the expiration date of the digital ID, the serial number of the digital ID, and name of the certification authority that has issued the digital ID. At the same time, it will be having digital signature of the certification authority that has issued the digital ID. And it may also contain some user supplied information such as the address, email address, and basic registration information such as the country, zip code, age, gender, etc. So the VeriSign three levels of or the classes of security for public key certificates as summarized in this particular table. A user requests a certificate online at VeriSign's website or other participating websites. So there are class 1 and class 2 requests are processed online. In most of the cases, it will take only few seconds to approve. The procedure is clearly mentioned, identified or is explained in this particular session. So for class 1 digital ID, for class 1, the digital ID VeriSign confirms that user email ID address by sending a PIN, and the digital ID pickups the information to the email address provided in the application. So for class 2 digital ID, VeriSign verifies the information in the application through the automated comparison with the consumer database, in addition with performing the checking of the associated with the class 1. And finally, the confirmation is sent to the specified postal address, alerting the user that digital ID has been issued to his or her name. The class 3 digital ID, VeriSign requires the highest level of identity insurance or assurance. Individual must prove his or her identity by providing a notarized credentials as well as the applying in person. So in class 1, the summary of the confirmation identity comprises of unambiguous name as well as the email address search. The private key protection that is provided is trustworthy hardware in terms of PCA and CA in terms of trustworthy software or trustworthy hardware. So while downloading, we get this notification stating that the website you are attempting to visit is not secure, or it is not trustworthy to download this particular files from this particular website. All those identifications are issues issued by the individual certificate authorities in that case. So the application implemented usually class 1 are in terms of web browsing as well as certain email usages, and class 2 has a next level of implementation wherein it will provide an individual or intra or intercompany emails and online subscriptions for different newsletters or different shopping websites and other softwares and the software validations. The class 3 usually comes for the advanced version of the transactions that is performed on online, that is in terms of e-banking, database access, personal banking, membership based online services, content integrity services, e-commerce servers and server validations, authentications and strong encryption for certain servers has been implemented in this case. So as the outcome, it has been implemented in the class 1, it will just, you need to enter minimum amount of information for which the certifying authority, that is VeriSign, will send you a unique code either to your mail address, and that has to be verified. In class 2, it is next level, wherein it will verify your email address along with the other level of implementation, where either it will go for the two-step validation process. Class 3 comes when for each individual stage you have to enter their CAPTCHA codes, or you have to prove that you are an legitimate user, you have to while doing the transaction. So usually we encounter the class 3 level of VeriSign certificate in case of net bankings, or in terms of online shoppings, will be experiencing this kind of operations. Next, we will be considering the enhanced security services. The enhanced security services is in relation with what we have considered already in the case of MIME. So as it is clearly mentioned, it will be providing RFC 2634 is adding four enhanced security services for MIME. First one is the signed receipt. Signed receipt may be requested for a signed data type of the object. So returning signed receipt provides a proof that it has been successfully delivered, and the information is sent to the originator of the message, and allows the originator to demonstrate a third party that the recipient has received the message. So in this essence, the recipient signs the entire original message plus original signature and appends a new signature to form the new MIME message. So this will enable an originator of the message to tell that the information has been delivered to the receiver, claiming that the returning signed receipt has been successfully completed. And it will enable the second service, which is security label. Security label may be included in the authenticated attributes of the signed data object, which will let, and security label is a set of security information regarding the sensitivity of the content that has been protected by the MIME encapsulation. So it may be used for access control by indicating who are permitted to access the object. This may include in terms of priority, that is in terms of whether it is very secret information, confidential information, or restricted information, and so on. And it may be role based in describing which kind of people can see the information, whether for example the patient healthcare team or the medical billing agents. So there are individual role based identities, could have the security labels. Dependent on their role, they'll get to access the particular type of the information. Then the third service is in terms of secure mailing list. When user sends a message to multiple recipients, a certain amount of per recipient processing is required, including the use of each recipient's public key. The user may be relieved of this work by making use of a service called as MIME mailing list agent, that is MLA. An MLA can take single incoming message and perform recipient specific encryption for each of the recipient and forward the message. So the originator of the message need only to send a message to MLA. MLA will encrypt this entire information by making use of individual recipient specific keys, and individually he'll encrypt the message and he'll send. So thus the burden on the sender part has been reduced in this particular case. And the last service is in terms of signing certificates. This is usually used secularly to bind a sender certificate to their signature through the signing certificate attribute. So next we'll consider the background on domain key exchange. So there is a specific occasion of cryptographically signing the email messages, permitting the signing domain to claim the responsibility for the message in the mail stream has been considered. So there were the need in terms of domain key identified mail for the specific application, such as the communication within the domain. For example, Gmail is a domain, Rediffmail is a domain. So when from one domain to another domain, the information exchange has been employed, in that particular case, it is required for the specific cryptographically signing of the email messages so that it will permit a signing domain to claim the responsibility of the message in the mail stream. So the message recipients are capable of verifying the signature by querying the signer domain directly to retrieve the appropriate public key, as well as confirm that message is attested to the party possession of the private key for the signing domain. In this particular case, if I'm receiving a mail from other domain, for example, I have a Gmail account, I'm receiving a message from a guy who is using the Rediffmail. In that particular case, the message has been signed by Rediffmail and it is communicated to Gmail. In this case, the mail recipient, that is from Gmail, I can verify the signature by asking the signer domain directly, that is asking a Rediffmail guy directly to confirm that message is attested by the individual user who is a authorized user of the domain. So it was a proposed internet standard RFC 6376, that is domain keys identified mail signatures. It is widely adopted by number of email providers such as corporation or the government agencies, Gmail, Yahoo, and many internet service providers, that is ISPs, are using this kind of domain key identified mail service. Now, the email threats under domain key identified mail has to be considered pretty seriously. So RFC 4686, that is analysis of threats motivating the domain key identified mail, describes the different kind of the threats addressed by DKIM in terms of the characteristics, in terms of capabilities, and in terms of location of the potential attackers. And that characteristics are categorized in the spectrum of three levels of threats. So the first level is at the low end level, wherein attackers who simply want to send a mail that the recipient doesn't want to receive. That means the senders are intended to send a mail, but the recipient is not intended to receive. Attacker can just use a number of commercially available tools by making use of that sender can falsely origin the address of the messages. This will make difficult for receiver to filter the spam on basis of originating address or the domain. The next level of email threats under domain key identified mail, which has motivated DKIM, is in terms of professional senders of bulk spam mails. So usually these attackers operate as a commercial enterprises, and they send a message on behalf of a third party. That is where the advertising mails will be getting, either in the spam kind of messages or in the inboxes also sometimes you get messages. It is usually a bulk spam mail that has been sent on behalf of a third party, that is either on behalf of banks or on behalf of some individual products, we will be receiving the mails. So they make use of comprehensive tools for attacking, such as MTAs, registered domains, and networks of compromised computers, that is zombies, to send the messages, and thereby they harvest the address to which they have to send the mail. And the third level of threat is in terms of most sophisticated one, and the financially motivated senders of the messages who stand to receive the substantial financial benefit out of it, such as from an email based fraud scheme. the attacker expect to employ all of the above mechanisms, and they may additionally attack the internet infrastructure itself, and the DNS cache poisoning attacks and IP routing attacks falls into this level of threat. So next we'll consider the capabilities of domain key identification, identified mail, that is RFC 4686. The first one says the capability of an attacker might be in terms of he may submit the messages to the MTAs, that is message transfer agents, and as well as a message submission agent at multiple locations in the internet. Instead of initiating the attack at one point, he can initiate the attack at different parts. Thereby, he is communicating to different MTAs as well as to different MSAs. Second, he can construct arbitrary message header fields, which will include claiming to be the mailing list or the resenders or other mail agents. He can create a mailing list, thereby he can spoof the MTAs or MSAs stating that he is a legitimate user. Then he can sign the messages on behalf of domains which are under their control. He might have attacked or he might have threatened one particular domain of email service provider. Thereby, he can impersonate them by doing the message signing on behalf of the domains which are under them, their control. He can generate the substantial number of either unsigned or apparently signed messages that might be used to attempt a denial of service attack. Here, denial of service might be the person may not be able to receive mail or send mail or any service that is provided by email if is not provided properly, that is referred as denial of service. Then the attacker may resend the messages that have already previously signed by the domain. He may transmit the message by making use of any envelope information that desired. He can act as an authorized submitter of the message from the compromised computer. The computer which is under attack, he may make use of that particular computer to generate the messages. So on outset for the domain, it appears that he is an authorized submitter. He can manipulate the IP routing. This could be used to submit the message from specific IP address or the difficult to trace addresses. Sometimes it will cause the diversion of the messages to a different specific domain. And he can have the limited influence over a specific portion of DNS using mechanisms such as cache poisoning, which will influence the message routing or to falsify advertise the DNS based keys or the signing practices. The attacker may gain access to the significant computing resources such as worm infected zombie computers. This will allow an attacker to perform various type of brute force attackers. And finally, it will allow him attacker to have the ability to eavesdrop the existing traffic in terms of whether it is a wire network or in terms of wireless network. So next we'll consider the strength or the fact on which the DKIM works. So basically, DKIM focuses on the attackers located outside the administrative units of the claimed originator or the recipient. So DKIM is not part of the it works basically on the attackers who are located outside the administrative units, and these administrative units maybe frequently correspond to the protected portions of the network which is adjacent to the originator or the recipient. In this area, the trust relationships are required for the authenticated message submission will not exist, and it will not subsequently scale to be practical. At the same time, within the administrative units, There are a few mechanisms such as authenticated mail submissions that are easier to deploy and more likely to be used than DKIM. Because of the fact, this particular fact, usually DKIM, because of the already existing capabilities which are pretty simpler than DKIM, it will not operate inside an domain, our administrative domain or unit. He'll operate, the DKIM will operate outside the administrative units of the claimed originator or the recipient. So DKIM usually attempt to exploit any to any nature of the emails that will motivate most of the MTAs to accept the message from anywhere for delivery to their local domain. They may generate the message without signatures or with incorrect signatures or with correct signature from the domains which are not traceable or which has little traceability. And at the same time, they may also pretend as greeting cards or the mailing list or the in terms of agents that has legitimately they can send or resend the mail on behalf of others. So user will create a message and he'll submit the message to MSA via SMTP, and here the ISPs or the email facility services will sign the message, and the signed message will pass to the internet through multiple MTAs at the destination. The MDA retrieves the public key for the incoming message signature and verifies the signature before passing the message onto the destination email client by making use of POP to the MUAs. Here we have two different parts. One is mail originator network and second one is mail delivery network. So the operations performed on message originator network is pretty much similar to the internet mail architecture, which what we have considered and what we have discussed in SMIME as well as in PGP. Whatever the message that is created by the message user agent, which is a local email, which is a local email client program, and that will submit the message or mail to the MSA. At MSA part, this content of the message plus RFC 5322 headers are signed by the email service provider, and that will be relayed to the multiple MTAs until it reaches the intended destination's MDA, that is message delivery agent. But message delivery agent will not directly submit the mail to the message user agent of the receiver. Instead, he asks for the DNS public key query and he receives the response from the DNS of the mail originator network. If both the signatures are verified, only then the mail is submitted to the intended recipient. We'll consider the DKIM functional flow. So it is implemented, provides a detailed look of the DKIM elements operation. The basic message is divided between the signing administrative management domain, that is ADMD, and verifying ADMD. At the simplest, this is between the originating ADMD and delivering ADMD. So signing is performed by the authorized module within the signing ADMD and uses the private information from the key store. As you can clearly see, we have a 5322 message which is originating or relaying the ADMD, or sign. The other option is the sign the message with ADMD. Here it retrieves the key from the private key store. And within the originating ADMD, this might be performed by either MUA or it is implemented by MSA or MTA. The verifying is performed by, and then that is transmitted through ADM internet. And the verifying is performed by an authorized module within the verifying ADMD. So within a delivering ADMD, verifying might be performed by either MDA, MTA or MUA. The module verifies the signature and determines the particular signature was required. So the verifying signature uses the public information from the key store. So now I have to verify the signature. I'll make use of the public key that is retrieved from the public key store to verify the signature of the either relaying or the delivering ADMD, whether the message is sent. If the signature passes, the reputation information is used to access the signer, and that information is passed to the message filtering system. If the signature fails, and if the relaying or the delivering ADMD, the message is not signed, in that particular case, it will check for the signing practices which is not using the author's domain. Information about signing practices related to the authors can be retrieved remotely or the locally, and that information is passed to the message filtering engine. For example, the sender from Gmail is using DKIM, but no DKIM signature is present, then the message may be considered as a fraudulent message. Then the signature is inserted into a 5322 message as an additional header and entry starting with a keyword DKIM signature. One can view the example for incoming mail by making use of view long headers option for the incoming message. So we'll consider the DKIM signature fields. It comprises of around 8 fields. So each of the field begins with a tag consisting of a tag code followed by equals sign, and it ends with a semicolon. So the first field is V, which is nothing but the DKIM version that is being used. And second field is algorithm that is used to generate the signature. It might be either RSA-SHA-1 or RSA-SHA-256. And third field is the canonicalization method that is used on the header as well as the body. And the fourth one is D, that is a domain name that is used as an identifier to refer the identity of the responsible person or the organization. In DKIM, this identifier is called as a signing domain identifier. So at the message originator part, this gives you information regarding the signing domain identifier, which is also referred as SDID. So for example, this field indicates the sender is using a Gmail address. So next is, this is nothing but the different keys that may be used in different circumstances for same signing domain. So since the old keys will expire, there is a requirement for departmental keys or new keys for each individual case. So it defines a selector. So one can select the different verifiers to retrieve the proper key during the signal verification. Next field is H, which is a signed header field. A column separated list of the header field names that. It is a header field presented to signing algorithm. So in our example, one can consider the signature which covers the DK signature field is also referred as an older algorithm that is replaced by the DKIM that is still in use. So BH is nothing but the hash of the canonicalized body part of the message, that is the base64 encoded message for which the hash code is calculated, that is stored in BH, and which will also provide the additional information such as diagnosing of the signature verification failures. And the last field is B, which is a signature data in the B base 64 format, and this is an encrypted version of the hash code. So that completes the module 2 of the network and cyber security, that is email security. In this particular module, we have started off with a pretty good privacy service that is provided, followed with the MIME extensions, the type of the MIME messages we have, MIME formats we have, and MIME types of the contents we have, the transfer encoding techniques we have considered, and the extended version of MIME, that is secure MIME, we considered, the different aspects of operational principles of SMIME we have discussed, and finally we have considered the last part, that is domain key identified mail operations. That completes this video of module 2. Thank you.